Hello everybody. In the beginning I would like to welcome all the audience who are now watching this video broadcast and all those who will join us shortly. In addition, I cannot fail to thank the group Sudanese Sonographer Society, which is abbreviated as SSS, on Facebook for making this event possible as a live broadcast right now through their page. This lecture entitled as Sonography of Myometrial Abnormalities will be the beginning for a series of three educational lectures in the specialization of ultrasound in gynecology and obstetrics. The aim of this series of lectures is to broaden the free scientific knowledge of the professionals of ultrasonography. I'm Professor Mustafa Zuhair Mahmoud, professor and consultant of ultrasonography, and I will be the speaker through this lecture. So let's start together our lecture today. And as I told shortly, its title is Sonography of Myometrial Abnormalities. And actually, before we start mention the outline of this lecture, I would like to stop in this slide for a while. And if you concentrate well, you can see here the title is Sonography of Myometrial Abnormalities. And in this slide, we have several images. Let's start with the image appear here in the upper part of this slide, and you can see this image is an anatomical image. What is the benefit of this image? The benefit of this image is to teach the audience what about the female reproductive system, and actually about the female reproductive system, we can see this part here is a vagina, and actually this part which is the vagina is connected with the uterus. But actually the uterus consists of three parts. The first part of the uterus, which has a direct contact with the vagina, is the cervix. In addition, the remaining two parts of the uterus are the body beside the fundus. And as we already know, we know that the cervical canal consists of two openings. One opening, this opening here named as external os, and it's open here towards the vagina, while the other opening here located at this side known as internal os, and this internal os make this cervical canal join the endometrial cavity as well. Beside this, we have two fallopian tubes. This one is left fallopian tube, and this one appear to you here at your left. Actually, this one is the right fallopian tube. Also, we have two ovaries. So the benefit of this image that I'm putting the pointer at it right now is to just make a revision for the audience about the anatomy of the female reproductive system. Still, we have other two images. We are going to talk about them as sonograms, because actually they are ultrasound images. This one here is describing a type of scanning done through ultrasound to the uterus, and this kind of examination is known as transvaginal ultrasound. And here is how the uterus appear in transvaginal ultrasound examination. We can start labeling different anatomical parts present in this image. Here we have a fundus, and this area here is the body of the uterus, and here we have cervical canal or the cervix. Also, you can see we had add a coloration to this image to make it easy for the viewer to get the anatomical information in a simple way. And if we start labeling according to the appearance of color, we can recognize that this part which is colored in red, in addition to this part which is colored in pink color, are referring to a muscular part of the uterus, and this muscular part of the uterus known as myometrium. And from another and in addition to our previous information, we can get to say that the endometrium consists of two parts. The first part is the inner myometrium, and we can label it as junctional zone. In addition to that, we have the outer myometrium. So myometrium consists of two parts, outer myometrium and inner part of myometrium, and this one is known as junctional zone. Much more, we are going to introduce ourselves deeply inside the uterus, and here we come to this part color in yellow color, and this part which is color in faint red color, we can label it as orange color. And you can see these two parts are referring to the endometrium, and actually the endometrium, which is the inner part of the uterus, is consist of striatum basalis layer in addition to the functional part of the endometrium, which is known as striatum functionalis. So from this sonogram we study how the uterus look like when scanned through transvaginal ultrasound or through TVS sonography. Also, I would like to remind you again, when we see the fundus of the uterus at the left side of the screen, directly we understand or we get information from the image that this uterus is antiverted. Vice versa, if we find or if we found the fundus of the uterus rather to be located in the left side of the screen at this side here, which is the right side of the screen, directly here the information that we get is that this ovary is retroverted rather than to be antiverted. So going to repeat again, in this slide I give you an anatomical information starting from the first image, and again I sail through this sonogram in the middle, and I taught you how the anatomical structure look like when the uterus is scanned through transvaginal ultrasound technique. Lastly, in this slide we have a couple of image or a couple of sonograms, and actually this couple of sonograms, we are going to start with this sonogram. Here we can notice this anechoic black area is referring to the urinary bladder, and all this area here is referring to the uterus, starting from the cervix, body and fundus of the uterus, and this area here is the vagina. Okay, how do we get this image? We get this image by applying the transabdominal ultrasound examination at the area of the pelvic, and actually to make it easier for you or easier for you, all the area of the uterus along with the cervix in addition to the vagina is colored for you in green color. So right now we can skip this slide to start talking about the lecture outline. And actually I remind you again with our title today. Our title today is to talk about sonography of myometrial abnormalities, and such title like this to be discussed well and to be clarified enough, we should build our lecture upon several outlines. And here in slide number 3 you can see the outlines for these lectures. We are going to start with myometrial layers. Also, there is a short talk about arcuate vessels and monkey Burgess sclerosis. And shortly, you are going to get information about arcuate vessels. And actually, arcuate vessels, surely they are arcuate arteries and veins. And monkey Burgess sclerosis is a kind of deposition or a kind of dystrophic deposition of calcium inside the lumen of arcuate artery. Why this occur and how does it look like when scanned sonographically? This is going to be clear shortly. In addition, also this lecture include other outlines as myometrial dead cells. What this term stand for? Is there is any relation between myometrial dead cells and monkey Burgess sclerosis? Also, this will be discussed. In addition, I'm going to talk about a famous pathological condition commonly seen during ultrasound examination of the uterus, and this pathology name as adenomyosis. What about adenomyosis? And in your mind now another term, which is endometriosis. And what is the relation between adenomyosis and endometriosis? This question is going to be answered surely during this lecture. And what about the pathology which is known as endometrioma or chocolate cyst, which is generated due to endometriosis? In addition, I'm going to talk about fibroids or myoma or leiomyomata. In addition, I'm going to talk about uterine arteriovenous malformation, which is shortened as uterine AVM. After ending all this point, I'm going to conclude this lecture in the conclusion part, which is the last part of lecture outlines. So this is the outlines of this lecture. I think right now we can start directly with the first point in this lecture, which is about myometrial layers. What about myometrial layers? Here we are actually myometrium when scanned through transvaginal ultrasound examination. It will appear for the viewer, including three layers. The first layer is the inner layer. In addition, the second layer is the intermediate layer. Also, we have a third layer labeled as outer layer. And all this layer, either inner or intermediate or outer layers, are labeled for you in the accompanied sonogram by numbers from number 1 to number 3. And again, we are going to recognize that number 1 is referring to inner layer. Number 2 is referring to intermediate layer, while number 3 is referring to outer layer. Okay, what about E? Actually, E is referring to the endometrium. And right now, we are going to talk about these three layers sonographically, and we are going to compare their echogenicity with the endometrium. So let's start together doing this issue, and our starting point will be with the inner layer, and actually inner layer, which is labeled as number 1. This layer got several characteristics. It's a thin layer actually, and again it's compact. And when we compare its echogenicity with the echogenicity of the endometrium here, it appear as hypoechoic echogenicity when compared to the echogenicity of endometrium. Much more, we have layer number 2, and actually layer number 2 is named as intermediate layer, as you see here in this slide. And what is written about intermediate layer? The following fact were mentioned. It's sixth layer. In addition, its echogenicity is moderately echogenic when compared also with the endometrium. Lastly, we have the third layer. The third layer labeled with number 3. This layer is the outer layer. And actually, this layer is exoechoic or slightly less echogenic. So, right now, this is a talk about this three layers. I'm going to repeat them again. Inner layer, intermediate layer, and also the outer layer. I'm going to move to another part in this lecture, and another part in this lecture is about transabdominal approach. And actually, when I talk about transabdominal approach, I should also talk about transvaginal approach. What is the difference between them? How we do this kind of examination to clarify the uterus and its different part? Actually, the protocol in transabdominal approach should notice that the patient lies in supine position. And again, we have to fill the urinary bladder adequately. Much more, we can use a convex probe as appear for you in this image here. Also, convex probe is named as curved linear probe. In addition, we should apply adequate ultrasound gel. This is so important to avoid foundation of any air bubbles between the surface of the probe and the skin of the patient. And we can scan our patient in long axis. And when we scan our patient in long axis, as appear for you here, you can see this one is the urinary bladder here, and all this area is the area of the uterus in addition to the vagina. And as I told you, the uterus consists of cervix. We have the body, and also we have the fundus. The area colored with blue color, this is the myometrium. Again, this is a repetition of our previous talk that we discussed in it, the anatomy of the female reproductive system, especially the uterus when scanned through transabdominal ultrasound examination, especially in long axis view. And this pink color here is referring to endometrium. This area here is the vagina, and again, this is the cervix. So this is the image that we gain when we scan the uterus in long axis plane, or when we scan the uterus with sagittal plane. In addition, we can get this image also. And this image actually is a short axis, in short axis plane. What about the anatomical structure that we see? We see the following. This one is the urinary bladder. Here we have the endometrium. Also here we have the right ovary, and here we have the left ovary. The blue area here is referring to myometrium, while for here we have the endometrium. So this how we scan the uterus using transabdominal approach. I will repeat for you again, the patient must be or should be lysobine. We have to apply adequate filling of urinary bladder. And again, convex curvilinear probe is used. We should apply adequate ultrasound gel, and our scanning should be done in long axis view or in short axis view. Also, the female reproductive system can be scanned through transvaginal approach. And in transvaginal approach, we should firstly avoid any kind of infection transmission between patients. We should keep the hygiene. And this is done by dressing the transvaginal ultrasound probe with a cover. And as you see in the accompanying video clip, right now she is dressing this probe with a cover. And right now the cover is covering all the area of the probe to avoid any kind of infection transmission. Later, we should apply adequate gel. And before we start this kind of examination, we should prepare our patient in a form of psychological preparation. Firstly, by start describing this kind of examination, what is the step, how we introduce the probe, what is expected, if there is any adverse or side effect due to this kind of examination. And I'm going to skip this video clip to start playing the other video clip. I will come back to playing this other video clip. Sorry for this. Now this video clip is playing. Here we inserted the probe inside the vagina, upward to the area of the uterus. And we start, as you see, in sagittal plane or in long axis plane. And when we start in sagittal plane, we have to move fully to the left side of the patient and again come fully to the right part or right side of the patient, as you see. After we scanning everything, we are going to rotate the probe 90 degree, keeping the thumb toward us. And shortly, this will appear for you in the accompanying video clip. It will occur right now. Now look, she will turn the probe. Take a look here. Now she turns the probe, as you see. And in this state, the movement of the probe will be, or the sweeping of the probe will be upward fully and downward fully to scan all the area of the uterus and to searching the adnexia without forgetting the ovary as well. So that was a talk about the first point in this lecture. And the first point in this lecture was about myometrial layers. You remember how I classified in transvaginal ultrasound the myometrium to three layers, as layer number one, layer number two, and layer number three. Also, I taught you how can we scan uterus in transabdominal approach, either in long axis or short axis views, and how can we scan the uterus in transvaginal approach, either using sagittal or transverse views or sagittal and transverse plan to get the desired image. Right now, I'm going to move to another part in this lecture. And the second part in this lecture, actually, my audience will be about arcuate vessels and Munkebjerg sclerosis. What about arcuate vessels? Actually, they are arcuate arteries and veins. Okay, what about Munkebjerg sclerosis? As I said shortly, Munkebjerg sclerosis is a kind of dystrophic calcification that occurs inside the lumen of the arcuate artery. But before we start deeply like this, let's move step by step. And our step start by saying that arcuate vessels are a kind of blood vessels that lie between intermediate and outer layer. And actually, my audience remember that I labeled intermediate layer with number 2. And I labeled the outer layer with number 3 from the previous image that we see in this lecture. So the information here is giving you an information about where the arcuate vessels are lies where they are found. You need to know where they are found anatomically, and then you are going to check any abnormalities present at them. So again, they lies between the intermediate and outer layer, and actually we have arcuate, arteries, and vein, and this vessel aren't visible in intermediate layer. Why does they aren't visible in intermediate layer? Because per our talk shortly, we said that they just lie between the intermediate layer and outer layer. Okay, well, here we have this sonogram, and this sonogram is a kind of examination done through transvaginal ultrasound facility. You can see now the uterus is antiverted. Why it's antiverted? Because we see the fundus on the left side of the screen. Here we have the myometrium, and this bright stripe here is the endometrium. Okay, what about this tubular anechoic structure distribute along the myometrium? Actually, these are arcuate vessels. And as I told you, they are lies between the intermediate and outer layer of myometrium. Okay, well, I'm going to take another step in this lecture, and my another step will be with arcuate veins. And arcuate veins actually appear as serpentine tubular structure in periphery, but not within intermediate layer. Actually, such presentation is normal in childbearing year. Now I'm putting the arrow above the arcuate veins, and here how the arcuate veins looked when we put on color in color Doppler ultrasound examination. Much more, this is the signature of the blood vessel when the arcuate vein actually is scanned through spectral Doppler ultrasound, and this kind of flow is labeled as monophasic waveform pattern. So I hope you enjoying this lecture, and I hope my sound reaching you very well. Please, in the comment section, if you have any problem with the sound, let me know so to avoid missing any kind of information. Also, I take this chance to thank all the audience who are appear live with me right now in this video. So this talk in slide number 11 was about arcuate veins. Let's move. And now our step of movement is going to be concentrated upon the arcuate arteries. And when I mention arcuate arteries, our mind start to think directly about Munkebergs sclerosis. What is Munkebergs sclerosis? Actually, Munkebergs sclerosis is a kind of dystrophic calcification, and it associated with the deposition of calcium inside the lumen of the arcuate arteries. And when this deposition of calcium is dense, it's going to cause shadowing. And in ultrasound, we name such shadowing as posterior acoustic shadowing. And Munkebergs sclerosis is common in postmenopausal women who is affected with DM, and DM is abbreviation for diabetes mellitus, in addition to HTN, and HTN, actually this is hypertension. Okay, what the blow sonogram told us about this case? This is retroverted uterus right now. Why for? Because we see the fundus at the right side of the screen, not at the left side, as we already familiar with. Now take a look here at the myometrium. You can see this bright areas, and these bright areas are in a diffuse form, not in a localized form. The same feature is repeated itself again in this image, which is antiverted uterus. In this antiverted uterus, not retroverted in this case, you can see a diffuse deposition of calcium. And this diffuse deposition of calcium, as I said shortly, it will cause shadowing. And this shadowing caused due to this calcium deposition inside the lumen of arcuate arteries is associated surely with a condition misdiagnosed as hydrometrium. What is hydrometrium? Hydrometrium is a kind of accumulation of fluid inside the endometrial cavity. If we don't pay attention to this case, especially here at the area of myometrium, where there is an extensive deposition of calcium inside the arcuate artery, we are going to misdiagnose this condition, and a faulty diagnosis is going to be generated as hydrometrium. But actually, the case is not hydrometrium. The case in this state is Monkey-Bearish sclerosis. So watch out, be aware, use your facility well, and imagine in a good manner, and make your scientific level as high as possible to avoid such a mistake that I describe right now. So I think we fulfill a talk completely upon myometrial layers, and I give you a good information about arcuate vessels, and we shed light on a pathological condition associated with arcuate artery, which is Monkey-Bearish sclerosis. And we remember that the key point in diagnosis Monkey-Bearish sclerosis is the distribution, which is diffuse, of this deposition of calcium. Let's move to another part in this lecture, and our coming part will be with myometrial dead cells. What is this dead cells? What is myometrial dead cells? Actually, myometrial dead cells is a kind of actinic punctuate ecodensities in a various layer of myometrium. Again, the place of these ecodensities is within the myometrium. Why are we concentrated upon the myometrium? Because our lecture today is to teach you the abnormalities which affect myometrium through using ultrasound examination. So again, I repeat, our talk today is concentrated upon myometrium, nothing else. Endometrium and ovaries and fallopian tube, this will be our next talk in the coming days. So myometrial dead cells is a kind of a teeny punctuate ecodensities in various layers of myometrium. And actually, presentation of these densities, as I putting the arrow right now, you can look that these densities aren't diffuse as Monkey-Bearish sclerosis. They are localized. Their presentation in most cases is clinically insignificant, but some identified as specific entity. They may describe a placental site nodule, or they may describe an old calcified fibroid. Unfortunately, not unfortunately, actually, fortunately, our talk today include multiple information about fibroid. What about the type of fibroid according to its location? Also, I'm going to told you about the fate of fibroid. Also, we are going to study pelvic mimicker related to fibroid. So right now, this myometrial dead cells, as I say, most of them are clinically insignificant, but some of them are identified as a specific entity, for example, placental side nodule or old calcified fibroid. I'm going to move more, and my second step is a special talk upon adenomyosis. What is adenomyosis? Actually, adenomyosis is a common gynecological disorder. And this common gynecological disorder simply is characterized by abnormal presence of endometrial tissue. It's characterized by abnormal presence of endometrial tissue, and this endometrial tissue actually rather to be in its normal site, which is the endometrium, it immigrate and implanted itself in a myometrium. So when such condition occur, we are referring right now to adenomyosis, surely. Okay, if this is a description of adenomyosis, what for if this endometrial tissue, rather than to implant it itself in a myometrium, it implanted itself outside the uterus completely? For example, in the pelvic cavity, especially pelvic floor. What if this migrated endometrial tissue implanted itself, for example, in the ovary? If such a condition occurred at the ovary, right now a pathological condition is going to be generated, and rather to label it as adenomyosis, the right term for it is endometriosis. And endometriosis is associated with endometrioma, which is a kind of cyst developing at the area of the ovaries, and it also known as chocolate cyst. I talk about this part while coming in through this lecture. I need right now you to concentrate with me. Here, this is how the normal uterus look. But here, you can see the deposition of adenomyosis. Several nests of endometrium is implanted itself away from the endometrium and implanted itself at this time at the myometrium. So the condition here is labeled as adenomyosis. Much information about adenomyosis. Actually, adenomyosis in almost cases affect premenopausal women, especially if this premenopausal lady is more than 30 years and she got a history of multiparous. Also, this pathological condition can affect also postmenopausal women rather than premenopausal women. And adenomyosis frankly associated with several clinical features, and these several clinical features are menorrhagia, dysmenorrhea. Right now I'm going to just mention the term, and after I end mentioning this term I will clarify them. So clinical features associated with adenomyosis is menorrhagia, dysmenorrhea, dyspareunia, and pelvic tenderness. What we mean by menorrhagia? Actually, menorrhagia, it's a condition associated with excessive bleeding during the menses, or what we say as heavy bleeding. Also, lady with adenomyosis can develop dysmenorrhea, and dysmenorrhea, my audience, is difficult in menstruation. Much more, she can affected with dyspareunia. What is dyspareunia? Dyspareunia is difficult in intercourse with her partner. In addition, this lady can affect with pelvic tenderness, and actually pelvic tenderness is a kind of a pain localized at the area of the pelvis. So if we have this clinical feature, which are four as menorrhagia or dysmenorrhea, dyspareunia, and pelvic tenderness, we should junctioning this clinical feature with our ultrasound finding to start getting our diagnosis actually, or which is actually referring to adenomyosis. In addition to this information, in a medical field, it's already known that adenomyosis is an underdiagnosed condition. Why for it's an underdiagnosed condition? Because its symptoms and finding may not correlate. And as we already know that ultrasound is an operator dependent, so we have to overcome this limitation. And this limitation is overcome is through meticulous scanning, and scanning real time are required. Also, additional point of improvement include using high resolution transvaginal ultrasound. MRI correlation should be done. I mean here, we should compare our finding in transvaginal ultrasound or in transabdominal ultrasound for cases of adenomyosis with MRI. Why for with MRI? Because as we already know, the best facility to scan soft tissue with best contrast and resolution is MRI rather than ultrasound itself. And again, we have to increase our awareness. And this awareness should be in a form of high heightened awareness. All these points, their goal is to avoid misdiagnosis of adenomyosis. In addition, adenomyosis can be defined. Here I'm going to give you an addition definition for adenomyosis. So to make the view complete for you right now, so the flow of information shortly will be easy for you. So in addition, adenomyosis can be defined as ectopic endometrial glands and stroma within the myometrium with surrounding smooth muscle hyperplasia and hypertrophy. And the last two term, which is hyperplasia or hypertrophy, is the key point in diagnosis of such condition, which is adenomyosis. And again, adenomyosis can be diffuse with multiple nests of endometrium distributing itself along the myometrium. In other cases, adenomyosis can be in a focal form only. And right now you can imagine the severity of clinical feature in such a case when compared to the severity of clinical feature in such a case. Much more, sonographic finding of adenomyosis are variable. They are depend upon distribution, muscular hypertrophy, and cystic areas. And now we come to our point of specialization, which is to see how this adenomyosis look like in ultrasound examination. Here we have this image of the uterus. We get this image through transabdominal approach. You can notice this anechoic black area here is referring to the urinary bladder. Here we have the uterus. This is the fundus. Here is the body. And this area is the area of the cervix. This is the endometrium. This layer here is a layer of myometrium. But what about this layer? All this layer is a layer of myometrium. But what occurs at it? It looks like there is a kind of hypertrophy. So asymmetrical wall thickening is a key factor in diagnosis adenomyosis. And this asymmetrical wall thickening with enlarged globular uterus is one of the sonographic features that we used or that we must use to diagnose adenomyosis. In the second step, we should compare our finding in ultrasonography with MRI. And this is an MRI image where you can see the uterus. There is a kind of non-equality in the thickness of myometrial walls. Look at this wall. It looks normal in size, but this wall is large in size. And again, this wall is heterogeneous, not non-homogeneous. Why for? Because you can see that there is a distribution of several bright dots. And these several bright dots or echo densities are surrounded by a black halo or anechoic halo. And the latest features that I mentioned are also considered as a guidelines to diagnose adenomyosis. In addition, adenomyosis will appear with heterogeneous texture, as I told you. Look here, this is the myometrium, and here this is the myometrium. If you concentrate at the myometrium or focus at the myometrium, you can notice that there is a kind of a heterogeneity. The myometrium lost its distinct feature that we describe them in the beginning of this lecture by dividing the myometrium to three layers. As outer layer or intermediate layer or inner layer. The same issue is occurring here. Here there is a kind of heterogeneity or heterogeneous echo texture or coarse texture of the myometrium. And this heterogeneous echo texture can be added to the list of sonographic features that are used to diagnose adenomyosis. In addition, I'm going to add for you another sonographic feature, which is indistinct endometrial myometrial border. If you come to this image, you will fail actually to determine does the myometrial with this thickness or is the does the endometrial with this thickness or all this area is the area of endometrium. So right now there is a confusion start to be appear, and this confusion occur because there is a kind of indistinct endometrial myometrial border. And this indistinct endometrial myometrial border will make us think of pseudo-widening of endometrium. Somebody, if he see this image, he will say there is an enlarge in the endometrium. But actually, there is no enlarge in the endometrium. This is a kind of pseudo-widening of endometrium. Why does it occur? Actually, it's occur due to indistinct endometrial myometrial border. How can we prove this is a kind of pseudo-widening rather to an enlargement of endometrium? And the enlargement of endometrium is a hazardous for us, because directly we start to think about endometrial polyp, intracavitary masses inside the endometrium, or endometrial carcinoma. So such case can be proved correctly. It's just a pseudo widening of endometrium by using sonohistography. What is sonohistography? What is saline infusion sonohistography? The video clip working right now will show you. We introduce this catheter, and this catheter is introduced until the internal os. It fixed there by a balloon. We introduce normal saline in intervals to filling the endometrial cavity. All this is accompanied by putting our transvaginal probe in its position. So when we apply such examination, we fill the endometrial cavity with this fluid, and actually fluids appear as black or anechoic in ultrasound examination. This image was taken in sagittal view, and this image was taken in coronal or transverse view. And if you concentrate at the endometrium or focus in the endometrium, you can notice that right now the endometrium is well, it's intact. There is no intracavitary masses, no polyps, or there is no any kind of endometrial carcinoma. Also, there is no deformity in the outline of the endometrium. So here we prove there is nothing inside the endometrium. And just what we see is a kind of a pseudo-widening of the endometrium. And this condition was generated due to adenomyosis. And right now, when you compare thickness of this wall of myometrium to the other wall in the other side, you can see here this wall is appear with normal thickness, but this wall is enlarged in size with coarse texture, heterogeneous texture, and all this sonographic feature are helpful enough to diagnose adenomyosis rather than to fail and generated a wrong report by saying there is a problem inside the endometrium or there is an enlargement of endometrium. And here the proof was done with the aid of sonohistography. Much more, in addition to this kind of sonographic feature of adenomyosis, we can add another sonographic finding, which is thin pencil shadows. If you look here at this image, you can see several shadows, and these shadows are labeling as thin pencil shadows. And these thin pencil shadows are a distinct features also for adenomyosis. Sometimes we can see, beside all this sonographic feature, a kind of echogenic linear strands or a kind of echogenic linear striations. Where are these striations? All this is a strand or a striation, which is echogenic. You can see it here. Also, you can see it here, this one and this one. And this echogenic linear striation or a strand extending into myometrium for sure are used to confirm our diagnosis toward adenomyosis. Also, in adenomyosis, in addition to mentioned sonographic feature, we can add with them the presence of myometrial cyst, and this distributed myometrial cyst as appear here or appear here and here. This also could be considered as a hallmark to diagnose adenomyosis. So from the past talk, I clarify for you what I meant by adenomyosis. I give you a definition about adenomyosis. What is the difference between adenomyosis and endometriosis for sure? Also, I told you that adenomyosis is an underdiagnosed condition. Why for? We clarified this. And how can we solve this limitation? We can solve this limitation by improve our facility by using high frequency ultrasound during ultrasound examination. And I meant here to use transvaginal rather than transabdominal, if you're suspicious, especially in a lady who are falling in the category who are likely to develop adenomyosis. In addition, you can use MRI examination Furthermore, high heightened awareness is so important. You should consider any lady who become or who come with feature as menorrhagia or dyspareunia or pelvic tenderness as a case of adenomyosis. This is what I meant by high heightened awareness. Another part in this lecture is about leiomyomata, and actually leiomyomata or leiomyoma or fibroid, it's a kind of a benign smooth muscle tumor that very rarely become cancer. And actually myomas or fibroid or leiomyomata, actually such a condition is characterized by several sonographic features. We use this several sonographic features to build a right diagnosis toward fibroid and nothing less or and nothing else. So what about this sonographic features which are used to characterize fibroid? They are follow. Fibroid is round. Also, fibroid and ultrasound appear heterogeneous. It may appear hypoechoic. Also, fibroid cause attenuation of sound beam. It also associated with contour deforming. It will deform the contour of the uterus. Also, fibroid may be subjected to calcification. And here we said often calcified. And in most of cases, fibroid aren't appear or aren't present as a solitary. It usually multiple. So let's start apply this sonographic feature upon this accompanied sonogram. And if we focus here upon the contour of the uterus, we can found that the contour is deformed right now or is deforming right now by this fibroid. And this point was labeled here as contour deforming. Also, this is fibroid and this is fibroid. This is fibroid. This is fibroid, also this is fibroid. And actually, this fibroid here are multiple rather than to be solitary. And all the fibroids that I mentioned, or I labeled here in this sonogram, are round, heterogeneous in shape, or heterogeneous in echogenicity, sorry, round in shape, heterogeneous in texture, and hypoechoic when the question is about echogenicity, and they cause sound attenuating. So if you need to diagnose fibroid correctly, you should keep in your mind these sonographic features, which are the typical sonographic features of the fibroid. And in addition, fibroids can be classified according to their location. Fibroid may be located in the muscle of the uterus, which is the myometrium only, and here it's named as intramural fibroid. As we see in this image, this fibroid is found in the myometrium and it actually settle itself or found a place for itself in the myometrial, in the muscle only, with no further extension. So here it labeled as intramural. Another form of fibroid according to location, it can be submucous. And this submucous can be intracavitary, polypoid, or pedunculated. In addition, fibroid can be classified as subserosal. And subserosal can be pedunculated or intraligamentous. In addition, fibroid, according to its location, can be cervical, vaginal, tubal. They will be pedunculated there. As you see here, this fibroid is pedunculated with this trunk or this stalk inside the vaginal cavity or inside the vagina. Sorry. And this fibroid is pedunculated in the abdomen with this stalk or this trunk. This is an additional image that I hope it make the picture clear for you. And here I have this image that I noticed some information on it. I want to share this information for you to use them as a point in differentiation between intramural and submucous fibroid. Look here, this fibroid, although it's found in the myometrium, but it's pushing the endometrial cavity to inside. So such kind of fibroid which is pushing the endometrial cavity to inside or pedunculated inside the endometrial cavity, this kind of fibroid is going to be labeled directly as submucous fibroid. And submucous fibroid is a dangerous type of fibroid because it's associated with complication in pregnancy. And this point is going to be addressed shortly during this lecture. But this kind of fibroid, it doesn't right now pushing the endometrial cavity toward inside. It doesn't deform the endometrium here. It just located in the muscle, in the myometrium. So this kind of fibroid is intramural. Rather than this kind of fibroid, which is subserosal, and subserosal fibroid actually is found at the periphery of the myometrium or at the periphery of the uterus, especially towards the outer layer of the uterus itself, away from the endometrial cavity. So this image is useful for us to build a basis of differentiation between intramural or submucous and subserosal fibroid. Much more, what is going to be added, now our talk will be specialized upon intramural leiomyomata rather than to other forms of fibroid. And actually, intramural fibroid is surrounded by myometrium, as it's appear here, and the only way for treatment is using surgical approach to get rid from it completely. And actually, intramural fibroid, if they are large, multiple, and symptomatic, rather than this case here, we have only a solitary intramural fibroid. But in this case, we have multiple intramural fibroid. Are we going to use the previous plan of treatment, which is surgery in this state? Actually, no, we are not going to use the surgery as a plan of treatment. The best way to treatment them is using UAE. And UAE, this one is uterine artery mobilization. This one is the uterine artery mobilization. How uterine artery mobilization is occurred? Actually, we inserted a catheter inside the uterine artery, and after that, we injected. What we injected inside the uterine artery, we injected inside the uterine artery, especially at the area of the fibroid, an embolic agent. And this embolic agent frankly deprive this fibroid from adequate blood supply. So with the time, it's going to be shrinkage, and the last fate for it is to be calcified fibroid. So this point is so important. I described previously in slide number 38, how can we manage intramural leiomyomata, which is solitary. The management here is surgical approach, but in this case of intramural leiomyomata, which are multiple, not solitary, actually it's useless to manage them through surgery. The best management is to using uterine artery immobilization technique. Let's move to another type of fibroid according to classification. And actually, this type is submucous leiomyomata. And as I told you, submucous leiomyomata isn't surrounded by myometrium. It's surrounded by endometrium. And the best way to treat it is to using hysteroscopic resection. And if you see here in this accompanied video, you can see right now how we use hysteroscopic resection to get rid from this submucous leiomyomata. And as I told you shortly, that submucous leiomyoma are associated with pregnancy complications. And this complication developed during the pregnancy, or the complication associated with submucous leiomyomata upon the pregnancy, include recurrent miscarriage. Submucous leiomyomata or submucous myoma can lead to the development of premature labor, and abnormal presentation is going to be developed also. In addition, there will be a complication during the time of labor. So, or this complication are associated with submucous leiomyomata, and in the beginning I told you submucous leiomyomata or submucous fibroid is the dangerous type among the fourth type of fibroid that we classified them according to location as intramural or submucous or subserosal or different type of pedunculated fibroid. Now our talk is going to be directed to make a comparison between submucous and intramural fibroid. And this comparison, I mean by it, how can I determine in the image presented among of me right now and among of you, is this fibroid an intramural or submucosal? If there is any kind of uncertainty here about the location of fibroid, we can use saline infusion sonohistography. Saline infusion sonohistography or sonohistography, and I describe it shortly. And if you remember, in such technique, while transvaginal probe in its place, we injected through a catheter an adequate interval of normal saline inside the endometrial cavity, and we start imaging. So to make sure if there is any pathology affected the endometrium or not. And in this case, this is going to be applied also to determine if this fibroid is submucosal or intramural. How this is done? It's done like this. Here we filled the endometrial cavity with normal saline through sonohistography, and right now you can see the endometrial cavity is intact. There is nothing inside the endometrial cavity, and the outline aren't deformed. They are well. So directly, without any hesitation, and right now, there is no doubt to diagnose such fibroid as intramural rather than submucous. Okay, what about this example? This is a transvaginal examination of this uterus. Here is the fundus. This uterus is antiverted. But while we're scanning this uterus, we notice this mass. And all the sonographic features here are compatible with fibroid. Okay, right now. Okay, right now. What about the location of this fibroid? Is it submucosal or intramural? Actually, we should improve our examination method by directly transverse this patient to be examined by sonohistography. And when this patient is examined with sonohistography, while we filling the endometrial cavity, right now we notice that this fibroid is pushing the endometrial cavity to inside. It deforming the contour of the endometrial cavity. So when we see such feature, with no doubt and directly, we are assured that this kind of fibroid is submucosal fibroid rather than intramural fibroid. So in this practical issue of this lecture, I think right now you are able to differentiate directly between subserosal and intramural type of fibroid. Let's move, and our movement right now will be with subserosal leiomyoma, which is the third type of fibroid according to location. And actually, it's a subtype of uterine leiomyomata that often project outward from a subserosal location. And the laparoscopic myectomy is the only way by which we can treat such kind of fibroid. Look here, this fibroid is found at the periphery of the uterus. It's away, very away from the myometrium, or sorry, from the endometrium. And you can see right now how they manage such a kind of fibroid. Let's move from this part to another part. And this another part is also in relation with subserosal leiomyomata. And I would like to inform you, such kind of management through laparoscopic myectomy for subserosal leiomyomata is only done for subserosal leiomyomata which are less than 8 cm. But if the subserosal leiomyomata or subserosal fibroid is more than 8 cm, the previous method of management or treatment is not suitable or it's useless. So right now we are going to use the traditional way in treatment of such a case, which is through laparotomy. The patient is going to be subjected to a surgery, and this type of surgery is known as laparotomy to remove such a mass. I will stop and check here, and my stop and check is done by remind you again or make you assure that I give you in this point an information about fibroid. I define for you what I mean by fibroid, and I give you information about classification of fibroid according to its location. And before this, I also shed light upon the sonographic feature, which are the typical sonographic feature of fibroid. We get further information about intramural and submucous fibroid, how can we manage them, and how can we differentiate it between them during or through ultrasound examination. What is the role of sonohistrography in such a case? Also, I give you several points about subserosal fibroid and how they are treated. Right now, our talk is directed to other part, but this other part is still under the umbrella of leiomyomata, which is related to secondary chain you care in leiomyomata. Actually, there are four facts that leiomyomata will be subjected to. It may either degenerate or a degeneration occur through several ways of degeneration, as hyaline degeneration, calcific degeneration, cystic degeneration, fatty degeneration, and in a very rare cases, leiomyomata can convert it to be sarcomatous. And sarcomatous is a very rare or a very seldom case. In addition, fibroid can be subjected to necrosis. Also, hemorrhage can be developed inside fibroid. In addition, fibroid can be subjected to infection and degeneration beside necrosis. In addition to hemorrhage and infection, these are secondary change in leiomyomata. Right now, our concentration will be upon degeneration, and the accompanied image here show you how the fibroid is subjected to a special form of degeneration, which is hyaline degeneration, and this is the most common type of degeneration, and the eventual result is the liquefaction and cystic change occur at this kind of fibroid. Much more fibroid, as I told you, can be subjected to calcific degeneration after a time, and this is a rare late result of vascular impairment of myomas. And as you see here, there is a calcification occur at the fibroid, and this calcification cause posterior acoustic shadow, this dark band posterior to this calcification. Also, the same manner is occurring here or was occurring here. This is in sagittal and this here in coronal. And when you see such a condition, avoid sinking on dermoid cyst or avoid sinking in a tip of iceberg. Here, this is a pelvic mimicker, and actually the condition that we see here, it's a kind of a calcific degeneration occur to this fibroid. Also, fibroid can be subjected to cystic degeneration. Look here at this fibroid, there is area of cystic degeneration, and if you look here from the first look, you are going to see this is twin gestation, but actually this is not a twin gestation. Here, I confirm this is a normal gestational sac. We can see an embryo, we can see a yolk sac, and this is amniotic fluid. But actually, what appear here, as I show you by the error or where I put an error, this is a kind of cystic necrosis occur at this fibroid. So avoid misdiagnosis in such a case. This is a pelvic mimicker, and actually the truth here, without any doubt, this is a kind of cystic degeneration occur at this fibroid. It's not a twin gestation, as you think. Much more, fibroid can be subjected to fatty degeneration, and fatty degeneration is a kind of degeneration where fat is deposit upon the fibroid, and the fibroid, due to deposition of this fat, during ultrasound examination, it will appear hyperechoic actually, and it will attenuate ultrasound beam. Also, one of the fate or one of a kind of a degeneration that affected fibroid is the sarcomatous degeneration. And this condition simply is that fibroid is going to lost its benign nature and be in a form of a malignant nature. And this condition, fortunately, is rare. It's between 0.1 to 1% in all diagnosed case with uterine malignancy. And this condition may arise de novo or from pre-existing myoma. And in such a case, we should watching feature of malignancy as rapidly gross or invading surrounding tissue. So if we scan a fibroid like this and we do our measurement and we found it, it's equal 7 by 5. If the lady come to you later or at another time and you do your examination and you found that there is a massive increasement in the diameter, so start to think about malignancy, because right now there is a kind of rapidly growing. And you should scan the surrounding tissue. Is there any kind of metastasis generated from this fibroid, which converted to sarcomatous condition due to sarcomatous degeneration? So I clarify for you different kind of degeneration, which is one of the vets of fibroids. Also, if you remember, there is a kind or there is a chance for fibroid to get infected. And this appear by this feature that we see here. And here we have an accompanying CT image. You can see this black areas, and this black areas is referring for a gas. And all this is a fibroid, and these gas bubbles appear bright in ultrasound image. So we should pay attention to gas bubble in myoma. Submucous myoma are most prone to infection and may lead to sepsis. And this is one of the adverse effects of submucous myomas. They may be subjected to infection due to twisting of its stalk if they are pedunculated. And in such a case, they will be deprived in blood supply or diminishing in the blood supply. And this opens the door for sepsis for sure. So if there is sepsis, there is a bacteria. Bacteria will release gas. So we should pay attention to gas bubble in myoma. Additional talk about uterine fibroid. In some cases, uterine fibroid may appear with a feature different to its typical sonographic feature. And in this state, we are going to name this feature as atypical feature characterizing uterine fibroid. And actually, this occurs if the myoma is solitary, if secondary change occurs, and if extrauterine location is detected for such a fibroid. And in this case, we should pay attention to the pelvic mimickers. And in this case, this fibroid is mimicking an ovarian mass. But actually, this is not an ovarian mass. This is a myoma subjected to cystic degeneration. In addition, from the first look, you will run directly to diagnose this case as endometrioma or chocolate cyst, which is associated with a condition known as endometriosis. And as we said early in this lecture, endometriosis is a kind of migration of endometrial tissue outside the uterus completely and settle itself in the pelvic cavity or in the pelvic floor, and it can settle itself or found a place for itself in the ovary. And here the condition is known as endometriosis, and the consequence of this condition is the developing of chocolate cyst or endometrioma. But actually, this condition that you see in front of you is not an endometrioma. Why for? Because when we put color on, we doesn't found or we doesn't get any kind of coloration inside this mass associated with movement of this debris or this fluid. So there is no doubt right now, this is a fibroid which is mimicking endometrioma. In addition, in pelvic mimickers, this is a calcified fibroid. This is not a tip of iceberg, which is a distinct feature by which we can diagnose dermoid cyst. Just this is a calcified fibroid, which is one of the fate of the fibroid under the umbrella of degeneration. Also, here, this is a uterus, and this is fibroid. But you, if you don't pay attention, you are going to label this condition as bicornuate uterus. So this is one of the mimicking or pelvic mimicker that developed due to atypical presentation or atypical sonographic feature of fibroid. Much more, it may mimicking pregnancy, as we talk shortly. This is not again a twin gestation. Only we have only one gestational sac. This is the yolk sac. Here we have the embryo, and this is amniotic fluid. But this area here, it doesn't resemble this gestational sac. It's just a kind of cystic degeneration occurring in this fibroid, and this is due to a typical sonographic feature of uterine fibroid developing such a case which is mimicking pregnancy. Again, a typical uterine sonographic feature of fibroid can mimicking ectopic pregnancy. And to make it easy, just put color on in color Doppler ultrasonography and searching for the ring of fire. Ring of fire is a feature that strongly confirm that the condition of ectopic pregnancy. Is there is any ring of fire here? Actually, there is no ring of fire seeing here. And this condition here is not an ectopic pregnancy. It's a uterine fibroid with a typical sonographic feature. And here we think that there are two heads, but actually there is only one head, which is here. And this is the placenta belonging to this pregnancy, and this is amniotic fluid. But what about this? Is it a head? Actually, it's not a head. It's a calcified fibroid where the calcification occurring just at the periphery of fibroid. So scanning in multiple views is so important. Improve your facility is so important. And discussion about the case with your colleagues also is so important. And all this steps that I mentioned is for the sake of the patient for sure. Much more, we are going right now to get in another step. And this step is a special talk about AVM. And actually, AVM is uterine arteriovenous malformation. But before starting with uterine arteriovenous malformation, I like to remind you again that our talk today was about abnormalities seen inside the myometrium by using ultrasound. It's the first lecture. It is the first lecture in this series. And this series will be about gynae and obstetric. We start today in Sudanese Sonographer Society. I thank them for giving me this chance to be online with you. And this lecture, as I told you, was about role of sonography or what ultrasound benefits in diagnosis of myometrial disorders. We start with myometrial layer. We give you an idea about the sonographic anatomy. What about our approaches, either using transabdominal approach or using transvaginal approach? What about arcuate vessels and Munkebérg sclerosis? Also, I discuss for you the myometrial details. And in details, I taught you about adenomyosis and leiomyomata or leiomyoma or fibroid. Now I'm going to talk about arteriovenous malformation, and the idea is clear for all of us about arteriovenous malformation. It's a kind of a rare vascular lesion which is involving myometrial in our case, or the endometrium. And the image below here show you this is a normal connection, but this is abnormal connection with worm-like appearance, which is a characteristic feature of uterine arteriovenous malformation. And this condition may occur as a congenital condition, but sometimes, or in most cases, actually, sorry, it may be generated due to trauma or surgery or pregnancy or due to abortion. Also, the irritation and keratitis, if it doesn't in a right manner, it can have an adverse effect, and this adverse effect surely is going to generate it for you arteriovenous malformation. Much more, the main characteristic of such a condition is abnormal heavy bleeding. The lady is going to be subjected or complain of abnormal heavy bleeding, and in 30% of cases of this heavy bleeding is requiring a blood transfusion. So how can we use our facility, which is ultrasound, to diagnose such a case? We can use two-dimensional brightness mode ultrasound. And arteriovenous malformation is characterized by the following characteristic or sonographic characteristic: myometrial inhomogeneity. Also, there is a kind of spongy texture, and there is a tortuous tubular cystic serpiginous structures. In addition, there is no mass effect. So, serpiginous structure with cystic tubular tortuous spongy texture along with myometrial inhomogeneity and no mass effect. All of this collectively referring to ultrasound features present in two-dimensional B-mode ultrasound. But in Doppler ultrasound, the feature is different because right now we put color on in this color Doppler ultrasound examination, and we have a kind of intense color with extensive color aliasing, and the feature which is present for us here is what is known as mosaic pattern. So mosaic pattern along with intense color and extensive color aliasing are the features, or are the common features, or are the famous features which present through color Doppler ultrasonography examination of arteriovenous malformation cases. And in addition, also arteriovenous malformation can be mimicked with other pelvic condition such as gestational trophoblastic disease or abnormal placentation and retained product of conceptus. And in such a case, simply we are going to ask a patient to do BTHCCD if the test is positive. So directly our mind is going to be changed toward gestational trophoblastic disease or abnormal placentation or retained product of conceptus. If BTHCCG is negative, so directly and with no doubt the case is going to be diagnosed as uterine arteriovenous malformation. Now I'm going to conclude to end this lecture by said the following: knowledge of myometrial disorders, particularly the sonographic appearance of this listed abnormalities during this lecture, will lead eventually to correct diagnosis and proper therapy for patient, and this for sure. And I would like to say, if you like this video, click on the like button. In addition, you may share the video by clicking the share button, so this streaming will reach to the largest possible number of audience. Also, subscribe to my YouTube channel named Prof. Mustafa Z. Mahmoud by clicking on the subscribe button to receive all new updates. In case of inquiry or any question, please feel free to contact me on Facebook through my personal page named Mustafa Zuhair. You can join me at Snapchat on my account in Snapchat name as Dr. Mustafa Zuhair. You can send me a message or either make a call through WhatsApp or phone as my number appear for you right now on the screen. Much more, you are welcome to send me an email at zuhairmustafa4@hotmail.com. And here we are in the part of a reference. I use AIUM, American Institute of Ultrasound in Medicine, resources and the guidelines for gynecological ultrasound scanning to prepare this lecture. Also, ISUAG, Society of Ultrasound of Obstetric and Gynecology, ISOG. I use their clinical resources for sure, guidelines. They were very helpful in writing this lecture. In addition, Sonware, client search result, there is a complete lecture about uterine abnormalities by Dr. Oksana. You can watch it also. It is very useful. I assure you that I do not pretend that this lecture is my own property. It's a simple re-explanation with new addition for colleagues inside and outside Sudan. Thus, in this part of the lecture, you will find references links that were used in its preparation, as I said shortly. And here in the end, I would like to thank you sincerely for attending this lecture. I hope that I had been able to convey its information in a useful, simple, and satisfactory manner to all. I'm going to finish this broadcast until we meet in another lecture from this series soon. So, see you, keep well, bye-bye, see you in the next lecture.